Don't kill the cat! Hello, and welcome to the first episode of The More I Learn, The Less I Know.
Hello. Again. I decided to record in live stream so I could avoid countless hours of editing and post. This is a serial? This is a series of a show that I came up with back in 2016, which is 7 years ago. And I often have like these questions that come to my head that I ask myself about things that I don't know, that I want to figure out, even if they're minuscule, unimportant things. And I started writing them down to later look them up online. This is Don't Kill the Cat, episode one. I'm going to be looking over a few topics. The topics of this episode are going to be, well, first we have a quote, we have an etymological overview of a word or a phrase, and then there's three topics, which I will explain as I go. I forgot to mention that I have a really long list. This list I've been building up as I've been going through my daily life. Some days I come up with 10 topics, for example. Some months I don't add anything to the list. I've landed on the Wikipedia page. This is where we're going to be spending most of our time on this show. I will try to add as much external sources as I can, but yes, Wikipedia, thank you, Wikipedians, for everything that you've done for the world. Anyway, split. The quote of this episode is, curiosity city killed the cat. Proverb. Curiosity killed the cat is a proverb used to warn of the dangers of unnecessary investigation or experimentation. And also unnecessary. See, who decides what we talk about? Who decides if it's necessary or not? It also implies that being curious can sometimes lead to danger or misfortune. The original term of the proverb, now rarely used, was care killed the cat. In this instance, care was defined as worry or sorrow for others. Origin. It appears in the play of 1598 by Ben Johnson. Let's take a look in the search engine. Ignorance killed the cat. Curiosity was framed. You can see the cat. I don't know how it's gonna be killed in this thing, in this photo, but yeah, maybe the cats are curious. Okay, let's just move on. Etymology. Etymology of the word etymology. Etymology. The scientific study of the origin and evolution of a word's semantic meaning across time, including its constituent morphemes and phonemes, which is, I guess, the way that it looks, the way that it's formed, and the way that it's pronounced, the word. Let's look into this. Morpheme, the smallest meaningful constituent of a linguistic expression. In phonology and linguistics, a phoneme is a set of phones that can distinguish one word from another in a particular language. A phone is any distinct speech sound or gesture, regardless of whether the exact sound is critical to the meanings of words. Etymology of the word etymology derives from the ancient Greek etymologia, and the suffix logia is the study or logic of. Etymon is the sense of a truth. That's perfect. The term etymon refers to the predicate, i.e. stem or root, from which a later word or morpheme derives. Yes, this is what I was talking about. You can find connections between relationships between etymologically related words, and you can understand what the idea of a certain thing was and what it might have derived from, like the development of a tool or whatever. The oldest entry was, how is orange juice made? Orange juice production. I was just curious to see the process, even if it's not like in depth. We can look at orange juice here as well. Orange juice is a liquid extract of the orange tree fruit, produced by squeezing or reaming oranges. One thing to note is, look at the way that they process the oranges. Obviously there's different grades. This, I think it's a mixture of the complete fruit, including the peel, which might be a bad thing for a few reasons. Most of the orange juices started becoming really bitter. The peel has some bitterness to it, but also it might be a trait of the pesticides that they spray, because they spray, like the mass-produced oranges, they spray them with pesticides, and it could be a quality of the peel that has absorbed pesticides, and also it's obviously it's bad for the flavor. But this, in this video, I remember, I think this is the one that we watched with my friend. This is the one where they obviously they filter it out afterwards, and they, this is a puree, they probably make stuff out of it, yeah, bars, yes, and desserts and stuff. And the other video that we watched, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to find it here, it was a cleaner produce, so they peeled the oranges before squeezing them or extracting the pulp. Yes, let's see, come on. No, this is a similar process, it just goes through everything. I think that's what this is though. Anyway, let's keep going, we have a little bit more time left. We're about to... Come on. Tasters. yes, palate cleanser.
So in tasting, what we do is aerate it.
Yes, the more manual labor that you see, I think that in such like, yeah, this is, see, this is peeled oranges. Perennial, this is interesting, I think. Let's go, perennial plant. A perennial plant, or simply perennial, is a plant that lives more than 2 years. Perennial. Etymology, perennial means through the ears, Latin. Is often used to differentiate a plant from shorter-lived annuals or biennials. The term is also widely used to distinguish plants with little or no woody growth. In botany, a bulb is a structurally a short stem with fleshy leaves or leaf bases that function as food storage organs during dormancy. Dormancy is the winter period, obviously. In gardening, plants with other kinds of storage organ are also called ornamental bulbous plants. I messed up my splits. Anyway, this should have been shorter. I also wanted to look at a list of perennial plants. There we go. Perennial flowers. Dahlia nepophila, hollyhock, lupin, daisy, salvia, phlox, foxglove. I wish I could just hover over these and it would just show me the plant, but I think tulips do that, and we have this little snow flower here. Perennial fruits, apple, blackcurrant, blueberry, currant, grape, pear, plum. Yeah, we have the grape vines that last through the seasons, and they cut the thin branches. Pear, plum, raspberry, strawberry. Herbs: fennel, mint, rosemary, sage, thyme. Vegetables: asparagus, chives, globe artichoke, Jerusalem artichoke, leek, New Zealand spinach. I don't know half of these. Rhubarb, sorrel, rakio, sea kale, kale, sweet potato. Aquatic plants. Wow, I never even, like... You don't even think about it until you read it. I guess I wanted to figure out how long it takes to heal. In humans. Blood supply. Tongue healing. Mouth and tongue cuts. Most mouth and tongue cuts heal on their own without stitches. Use salt water rinses and cold compresses to relieve mouth pain and swelling and to reduce the chance of infection. Tongue cut. Tongue cancer, you're dying. WebMD immediately tells you you're dying when you have an issue. First aid treatment for a tongue laceration. While eating, while playing sports, during sleep, during a seizure, while under dental anesthesia. Somebody's gonna cut your tongue in the dentist, at the dentist, that's sad. But I guess it's possible. As a result of an injury, such as a fall or vehicle collision, as a result of self-harm. Oh, hopefully it's unintentional. Symptoms. Fever. Wow. First aid. Wash the hands. Rinse the mouth. Yeah, so obviously soap and not soap for the mouth. Don't put soap in your mouth. Apply a gauze pad or clean cloth to the laceration. Firm, consistent pressure, stop the bleeding. Okay. When ask help, obviously, when it doesn't heal. Treatment. Depending on the sensitivity of the laceration, the doctor may use stitches. Oh, that's gonna hurt. Hopefully they use anesthesia. Antibiotics. Take a chill pill. That's not a good recommendation. Anyway, tongue cancer. Yes, see, look at all those body modifications. This is probably tattoos in the earlobe. What should you know before splitting your tongue deliberately? What are the risks associated? Constant bleeding of the tongue, obviously. Slight distortion in pronouncing certain letters, like saying the S but coming out as an F. sound. A permanent scar on the tongue, obviously. It's gonna be cut. Permanent scar. They consider it a scar, well, maybe in the inside of the incision. Discharge of pus-like substance from the forked region. Taste perception problems. Oh, that's gotta be harsh as well. Like, because the nerves are damaged or cut. Numbing sensation in the tongue. That'd be horrible if it's like long-term. Prescribe painkillers. Don't reopen the wounds. Consume liquid that aren't... and soft foods alone during the year. Rinse your mouth. Do not put too much pressure or stress the muscle too much. Rinse your mouth with salt water. Consult your dentist if the pain becomes unbearable. Bottom line. Self-mutilation. This is a good way to put it. You're basically doing something to your body that you cannot revert. You can't just tie it... well, maybe, but like you could like open, like cut the tongue and try to stitch it together. Obviously a doctor, but I don't know if that would be possible at all. And if it is, that would be painful, like five times as painful as splitting the tongue. Should get done by oral plastic surgeons. Obviously you're not gonna, or you might disfigure yourself. You might damage yourself, or you might bleed out and die. Don't do it yourself. Always consult a professional, and not just consult, but let a professional do it. Make sure the practitioners are licensed, obviously. We are telling again that tongue splitting performed by an amateur practitioner will end in myriad or horrific consequences. Yes. I don't know. Oh, he has his teeth filed as well. That's just whatever. Forking at the end. A rare congenital malformation associated with the maternal diabetes. Unintended. Yes, obviously this as well. If you have a tongue piercing and the opening splits the rest of the tongue, that's obviously bad because you didn't intend to split your tongue just for the piercing. Anyway, the outro is, thank you for joining me on this journey. I hope you enjoyed learning with me. It was interesting reading stuff like a little kid. That's the thing, the Curiosity series, it's accessible for everyone of all ages, especially if you want to learn, and especially if you're still curious about the world around you, as kids are. Willful ignorance is what I'm trying to avoid with this, because these topics, they're most of them are just like curious and interesting stuff, but some of these, like, you learn a lot of things about life and about how to go through life. My general thought is, like, I'm trying to enrich the life experience, and obviously knowledge is power. Knowledge is what helps propel the world forward, and knowledge and science and research and development and just this constant thirst for knowledge and for figuring out how stuff works. I'm looking stuff up, but obviously I'm sure that there will be times where we stop on a question which the internet can't answer, and maybe I'll be looking into how to take this series out of the studio and try to bring it into daily life and try to answer questions within the life experience. What I'm trying to say is, don't forget your curiosity, and don't consider it as something childish or shameful. As scholars say, there is no dumb question, there's no bad question. I'm not interested in the personal popularity aspect of this at all. I could even hide my face in these, it doesn't really matter. I want the viewer to build up this curiosity and to try to maintain it with the help of these episodes. See you next episode, where we'll be looking at more interesting stuff. Yes. Don't kill the cat.